feel pretty great.
Do you feel a bit nervous?
No, I feel
okay.
Like dad.
How can we change that?
I feel like dad's out of town and just do what I want to.
Yeah.
Answer the questions like a big boy.
Answer the shit out of those questions, man. All right, I guess that's it. Enjoy.
Roseanne! Hi, everybody. Goodbye to Billy and Mike.
Thank you.
He said thank you guys. I speak my phone. They're getting on a plane and going home. I know, it's sad. Not me. Not going anywhere. I'm gonna just wait by myself in the green room when this is over. Wait for this and the journey to be done. And then, or just drink by myself in the green room. But this has been really fun, you guys. It's fun to be back in Vancouver. I haven't been here since I was up shooting the last 4 episodes of last season. I just love the city. I love this convention. This is just great. So, thanks for being here and not being 65 now. I know I've been up for a while. Hi.
Hi, Robbie.
Hi.
So, since you don't have Matt or Richard on stage with you right now, do you have any embarrassing stories about them that are not the bed story that we heard in Seattle previous times?
But that involve them?
Either of them? Yeah,
too
embarrassed.
Don't
embarrass yourself.
Okay, I was going to say, I've got lots of stories about myself that are embarrassing. let's talk about it. It's a great question.
But yeah,
they're not here, so let's talk about it. Let's see. Well, the airplane story, you've all heard that. That's a good one. Let's see, embarrassing story about Matt and Rich. I really should. I mean, you know, Matt and I, it's funny because the dynamic is like Matt and I are always talking about Rich is like our grandpa. And then we each of us, if we're paired off, have a joke about the other guy, you know, and our joke, you know, Rich is that he's just a grandpa. And he also can't hear very well anymore, so it's getting worse. And sometimes when he's like editing our show, and he's got his glasses on, he can't hear, he's just like, it just looks like dad. You know, like your dad looking at the remote looking for the play button. That's Rich. And so that's what Matt and I feel sometimes about Rich. Rich, like in our meet and greets, it's the three of us. Rich just lately, he's just gotten real. He got real quiet. He kind of tunes out for a second. And I start repeating things that people are saying to him, like he can't hear. You know. Matt would be like, I went sailing last week. I'd be like, Matt went sailing, Rich! And then when me and Rich are together, and the only thing to make fun of Matt, Matt's a good person, really just a good guy. The only thing to make fun of him about is the fact that Rich and I have these things. We're here, the first one's here Friday morning, and the last one's to leave on Sunday, right? We're here the whole time. Matt kind of flies in. Friday night, it's all good looking. It's great. And then Saturday morning, he doesn't have to be here until like 1 or 2. So he works out. He's a facial, you know. Right? His skin bronzed. He doesn't do any of those things, except he does work out. But we always make fun of like, oh, look who just rolled in, boy, bro. Sorry to wake you up early. You know, he gets a lot of trouble from us about just being able to roll in, you know, Saturday, all groomed. Rich and I never see the gym. Even if we had time, we still wouldn't see the gym. And I think when they're together, they make fun of me for being everything. No, just for being, you know, all nervous and weird, neurotic, you know, shaky. I shake. I've got a thing where I shake. Like people in my family, like shake, like hereditary kind of thing. But I've been to I went to the bank one time, like cash a check. And it's bad when you shake me at the bank. You know what I mean? The bank teller was like, sir, to the place, they're like, are you okay, sir? God, I'm not going to it's a good check. Check's good money, but I have money. And like when I had the stroke years ago and we were at the hospital, and of course leave it to Rich to make a funny in the middle of this whole situation where the doctor's like, all right, so obviously it's made him shaky. And he's got, Rich's like, no. She shakes anyway. That's not true. That's his drop. So call up the docs. So anyway, I guess that's my embarrassing story, that I love making fun of them. Like, it's, we all take joy in making fun of each other, it's an act of love, really. So, anyway, I guess that's the best I can do.
Thank you, Robbie.
Yeah, you're welcome.
We love you, Robbie!
Hey, Robbie.
Hey, buddy.
So, first of all, last night was awesome, you guys. What I want to ask is, do you have any news or secret tips you can give us about the live album that's in the works?
Right, yeah, a lot of people have been asking about that. So a lot of people have been asking for a live album of the Saturday Night Special. And so we got together with Creation to record four shows over the last 7 or 8 months. And then beyond that, we've actually found a way to tap into the board and get recordings of every show. So what we're doing now, we're sifting through them all and looking for the best takes, the best performances. And as soon as Live Swing gets its own album, mastered, printed, and done, which will be in the next couple of months, then we're going to get to work on the live album, which is right on the heels of that. So it's just finding the right tracks, mixing it, and that kind of thing. And then that should be out, you know, hopefully a few months after the Live Swing album comes out. So it's going to be a big year, a lot of albums coming out for the Supernatural family. I can't wait, because you know, certainly what happens on stage is such a magical thing, and everyone that comes on and performs. So if we can get, what I've heard sounds really awesome, so I'm excited to get that in the hands of people, so I can hear it. We have like Jason Mann's cover album coming out later this week. It looks like it's going to be October. The Station Breaks album will come out. The Station Breaks is a band, a side project band with me, Billy, Jason, and another bass player and drummer that we know called Station Breaks, and we've got 12 new songs. And then the new Loud Sway album will come out a couple months after that. And then the live album will come out a couple months after that. So it'll be great. We'll box it.
Hello, brother.
Hello, sister.
You call me a force of destruction, but how do you feel knowing that you're responsible for the destruction of millions of women's ovaries worldwide? Especially after watching Sexy Daddy.
What?
Especially after watching Sexy Daddy.
Oh, some point. Oh, God, no. She's referring to something I did that is out there that people don't need to see. But thank you. And I don't know. I'm glad that we made up, though, and that we're actually talking again. And you look really great in that dress.
Thank you, Robbie. We love you.
I love you, too. Yeah, you know, it's funny, as an actor, you do things. You say yes to things. I do like to say yes. I always feel like I learn something every time I work, even if the project is bad. But, I didn't need to do that. That's the one I didn't need to do. And that's this thing that you're talking about.
Talk
some
more about it.
No, I'm not talking about that. But they're great things. They're things I'm proud of. You know, there's things, and I'd like you to focus on really the good stuff. Not judge you for the bad choices. You just never know, you know. But, right down the line. And yeah, with my on-screen dad. You know, that like, he thought it was fun. He thought it was going to be funny. Check that out. No, it's not. Sorry. And you know, it's funny, like like Waiting, we didn't know Waiting was going to be any good. We didn't know if people would accept it or like it or whatever. We were just having a blast with each other, and then that turned into this movie that people really love, and a lot of, you know, waiters especially love it, but they, I'm proud of that movie when I was in that movie, so you just never know. But, hindsight, you know, hindsight. 2020.
Alright, so my question's kind of a two-parter. First one is, did you know that your face is on a tortilla hanging in our house?
No.
Yeah, it's the one I used for the video, but it kind of dried up. So instead of throwing it out, we punched a hole in it and hung on the wall.
That's awesome. How big?
It's, you know, normal tortilla size.
Yeah, sure, normal tortilla size. Standard tortilla size. How did you get my face on there?
I drew it on there with Sharpie.
You did?
Yeah, it's a whole gone on a flatbread joke, but it's just kind of running.
I missed that part of your video. I was going to ask if you were the person in the
video. Yeah.
Good job.
Thanks.
That was well done. That's a lot of work.
Yeah.
Quite an
experience. We've spent a long time doing things that got all my friends involved. Anyway, but yeah, I wrote a song, and so it was all fun. But the second part of my question is how do you balance music and acting, and has that balance changed recently?
You know, I've always said that like they come from the same place in me, you know. I mean, I have a passion for acting, and I have a passion for making music. I just have a passion for music in general. But acting has traditionally been my bread and butter, and that. And so, even still, like, I mean, getting an acting job will take the place of, we'll have to trump having a gig. If we've got a gig planned, but then I get a job on a movie or TV show, then we can't do the gig. So that's always sort of been, you know, I got to do it because it's a job. But lately, you know, it's been, the music in the last 5 years has really kicked it up a notch, and largely thanks to all of you, you know, who want to listen. And the demand has been there for us to play in new cities and to go to Europe and play and all these things. So we're taking a lot of, the band certainly is getting a lot more of my energy these days. But I don't know how I balance it. I don't plan it out. I just love it so much, and I make it work. And at the end of the day, it just, it works out. It all works out. You look at your schedule and you're like, how the F am I going to pull this off? What do you do? You know? It's like, I don't know. I don't know why I thought this, but it's like having like a kid. You have a kid, like, how am I going to do this? You do it. You do it out of love. You do it. Then you have a second kid, and you're like, well, there's no way in hell I'm going to have the time to do this. Or do this correctly, and you do. You make it work, you know? And it's the most awesome thing that's ever happened to you, you know? And that's what it's like as well, like balancing all these projects. Like, when I don't have them, that's when I go into a depression. But when it's not there, so I'm loving everything right now because I've got so many great things going on, you know? I guess I just find a way. And I'm very, I feel very fortunate that I can do that, and the people want to listen, you know.
Hey, Rob.
Hi.
So back in season 5, there was the episode of The Real Ghostbusters, where there was the supernatural convention at the hotel.
Yeah.
And while Chuck is kind of rambling on about his life, he mentions that he fell in love and lost his virginity to a girl who said it didn't count. So, was that a reference to a specific person? Like, virginity, perhaps?
Oh. That's a big theory. It's a big theory. Wow, yeah, I'll buy that. I'll tell people that now. I'm totally taking credit for it, too. I like that theory. I'm trying to think of Eric wrote, because some of those lines I improvised, obviously most of them Eric wrote, but I feel like, I'm trying to think, does that sound very familiar to what actually happened in my actual life? So that might have been something that I just said, just to be silly, but it's kind of true. No, it's cool. I mean, it counted. It's more... I was really weird about it. It was like planned and stuff. She was like my birthday, and she like told everybody at school that she was gonna be my first. And then like she, you know, came over, my mom was out of town, and it happened. It was a great 40 seconds. And then I went to school next day, like, everybody knew. It was like news. It was weird. It's like, ooh, when's the rock band going to lose it? So that was my, that's the real life story. And I can't believe I'm telling you this right now. This story not a lot of people know, and now I'm telling all of you. It's Port Duber. It is Port Duber. Thank God no one's recording it, but. Next time we search YouTube, it'll be like, you know, fills it in, you're like, Rob Bennett loses his virginity story. Oh, God. Yeah, no, she was great. She was great. She was awesome. She was great. It's front page news, you know what I mean? It's like, my, it's my personal life. And I was like, walking the hall, be like, hey, good job, buddy. What? I wasn't proud of it. It literally 40 seconds of watching the clock. And now I'm going to watch the clock. But I'm looking at now. It's a long time ago. It was last week. But. But anyways, I don't know why I'm that tangent kid, but I might have said that on my own. And it's weird when you look at Chuck now and what we know about Chuck, and you're like, well, what was that? I mean, obviously, what we know about Chuck now was God playing a part. You know what I mean? God going incognito to sort of, you know, get back in the game. So you know, who knows what really happened, but. I love that episode so much, and that was really one of the first. Well, really, my whole character was like, was the story within the story. You know what I mean? It was meta, and I love that part of it. That one especially, because I'd never been to a convention before. It's funny you mentioned that because, like, I was just thinking, because I haven't done this by myself in a while, and the very first convention I did was in Chicago, like 2010 or something, and that episode had just aired, but I had never been to a convention before, so it just aired, and then here I'm on stage. Drinking water, kind of nervous and shaking. And it's like, oh my God, this is really, it's happening. What's reality? So that was that. And then lost my virginity and stuff.
That was after?
Huh?
That was after?
Yeah. No, that was joke. I really don't even know we go into ages. That was just too good. Vancouver, dry air, they always talk about. Anyway, so, yeah. I hope I answered a question. Okay, thank you. You'll hear everything.
Valid accepted.
Sorry, I'm having flashbacks to that episode.
Yeah.
Also, it's my own virginity story.
Congratulations.
Last 40 seconds.
Not there. Oh my God, is it? What are you doing here? What?
I was gonna say, you look great.
No.
Actually, okay. This is gonna be really awkward now with my question. So, you, as well as, like, you know, your character of Chuck and whatnot, super adorable, super cute, and lovable. And then you turned into God and got all aggressive and rawr. And why are we gay? I was wondering, for Criminal Minds Beyond Borders, are we going to see more of, like, the adorable, lovable, or more of the aggressive rawr?
Not so much the aggressive. But I know, I love playing the aggressive. I mean, it's, I love doing that too, you know. In general, it's like I love being able to have the freedom to be that. Because obviously as a person, I kind of, you know, I care what people think, and I, you know what I mean? You hide behind things, you have your ways. I have my own sort of ways to have a wall up, and you know what I mean? I think that's, you know, probably what you call the lovable side of me too, is like a little bit like, you know, don't hate me, it's kind of just how I was raised. But I love having the permission to be like, I don't give a shit. You know what I mean? Like, I really love that. And I feel like it, when I get to rock out with a band, it's just like, that's so free to be like, to feel like you own it. You know what I mean? It's a great, it's
you
free.
You do! Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for everything. I am in criminal minds. No, it's I'm more of a, I'm a victim. Yeah, me and Rich Bone. But Rich plays, so we're, I guess I could say this, yeah, we're designers and partners in design and clothing. But it says in the script, like, he's more the, like, artsy one, the ladies man, single, and I'm, like, I'm more the numbers guy, and married and baby on the way. So, that's why they're like, well, dads don't have beards, so I don't know, I don't know what, but people who know a lot about numbers don't have beards. I don't know what it is. Anyway, I shaved, he's got a beard, and he gets to be all cool dude, and I'm all, but I can work. Anyway, but it's gonna be awesome, I can't wait. It's fun, and Mac and Richard is great. We've never done it before, you know, besides our own show. It's the first time we've ever been on network TV together, so it's a great time.
Okay, first,
I'd
like to say that I've been able to
hug
you every day this weekend, and it's been amazing.
Awesome.
And I would also like to know what it feels like to be playing God, the creator of all.
I mean, I gotta tell you, it's pretty awesome. I mean, like, when the call came in that I was coming back to the show, and they were like, let the cat out of the bag, but this is what it is. I was like, this is my birthday? This is awesome. You know, and like, to come into a show like this, even with these actors too that have been working on the show for 11 seasons, and who are also now my, some of my closest friends. And they like, I piped down on God, so. it was fun, it's pretty fun. It felt like a gift. It was a real gift to play that part, and it's such a unique way to write it, you know, to write him like this, like inside the body of kind of a normal dude, but have these powers, and it was just a real gift, a real treat to play that part, and so yeah, no, it feels pretty awesome.
I was very happy to see you come back. I freaked out a little bit.
Awesome. Thank you so much. That was a joy. I mean, probably those four episodes were so fun. And now that we're all such good friends, I mean, that was the biggest difference between being there in season 5. We liked each other, but we didn't, like, hang out as much. And now it's like, you know, like I said, like, Jensen and I, like, get off work, just hang out. Brianna would be like, how's your boyfriend? You're totally jealous. Guy crushes on each other. Still do. but yeah, it was just so fun. And, yeah, it is awkward when people say, like, well, what are you doing on the show? I'm like, well, actually, I'm sorry, I'm God. Like, you don't have to call me that. But it's awkward to tell people who you play.
Okay. Hi. First of all, you have the most beautiful eyes. Like, they're mesmerizing.
I mean, I guess I thought about being a father, and that was where it came from. I'd done the sort of, given the sort of Chuck Godley look a couple of times, like, you know, at the very last shot of season 5, with the white shirt on, kind of like, all of a sudden, it's not Chuck anymore, or that 200th episode, where you're kind of like, not bad, and that, like, that was also sort of Chuck-like. And so I was like, went from there, but it was like, it came out like a father. And the scene with Jensen, he's like, where have you been? I felt like I was his father. That was especially tough because my own father left. And here he's saying, where have you been? And crying. And I had a really hard time with the two things. I was like, it's really tough for me to be this guy in this conversation, you know? So which was, I used that to in my response to him. That's sort of what I tried to play. It's really tough to, you know, be a father and have your son be saying that to you. So that's where it came from, is, you know, and then Nisha, you know, as Lucifer, Cassifer, was, I felt like father to son, that's what it was. So really, that's where it came out of. It's less about, like, I made you all, I'm all powerful. It's just more like a father who loves so much, but he's hurt. He's been hurt, you know, and now someone's coming to threaten to take it all away, and it's a part of it's like, just take it. I can't do it anymore, you know. So me, that was the arc, was about sort of finding that reason to keep fighting for your children, you know, and come back. So.
Thank you.
God. There's a scene where God like gestures to Chuck's face or your face and calls it a gift, and it's super cute, which is true. And so I was just wondering, does that mean Chuck was a vessel, or did God create that form of himself?
Well, I mean, God created everybody, right? So in that regard, yeah, he was a vessel that he created. You know, I mean, he's a vessel. God doesn't look like Chuck, but that's the vessel that he's traveling in. And yeah, he created Chuck. So yes and yes. How do you feel about that as an answer?
Great.
Good, good. I feel good about it. But yeah, I love the fact that he's hiding in Chuck's body and he's just like, really proud of it. And then the whole like, yeah, I've been doing great. Traveling around, had some boyfriends, had some girlfriends. Learned to play music.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, sure, that's all that he created. I'm going with that. I'm sticking with that. Hi.
How are you?
How are you?
After that virginity story, I feel like I had a weird talk with my dad.
You thought you had a weird talk? Oh, right. Like, as your father.
Sorry.
No, that's weird. It's weird. And
entertaining, but
yeah. Yeah, you don't want to hear about God lost his virginity. I mean, that's just me, right?
So my question.
Okay. We're good. You can see this right. Let's plop through.
Let me help you out.
Yeah.
You have played some amazing characters like Calvin and Weeding, or the Invisible Prince, or Chuck, both versions. How did you develop that range? Because it's so flawless. It's perfect.
Man, that's so nice to say that. Thank you. I just love acting so much, right? I love playing make-believe. I always have. And I think one of the things about me as an actor is like, you talk to put me in a box. It's always been a blessing and a curse, because you know, Hollywood is very much like, well, he's good-looking leading man, he's best friend, he's quirky-looking guy, you know what I mean? And I've always kind of felt that I kind of fit a little bit of all those things. The good thing about it is like I get to put on all these different masks and embody these different people. And I just love that. So in a way, that I guess that's what makes me a character actor. I love to play just different characters. It's so fun to sort of wrap your mind around a new person. And even when you play a good bad guy, like finding what makes that guy tick, you know what I mean? Falling in love with that guy because you got to play him, even if he's despicable, you know. I guess from a very young age, I knew this is what I wanted to do, and I always worked really hard and was in acting classes and just, you know. And I also, like, I'm the kind of guy that at a party, I'll find the corner of the room. I want to be at the party. I want to be talking to people, but I don't want to be walking around and being the life of the party. I'd rather, like, sort of just set up shop with some good friends and then just kind of watch people. And I like watching people. I love people watching. So, like, that's another thing. So, yeah, you just, what's that? Yeah, and it's not the thing, it just kind of goes into your mind, your little file. So I don't know what the answer is, but I love what I do, and I'm always like researching and looking and trying to meet new people and figure out who I am. I mean, it's a constant search to find who the heck I am. I don't know, you know, I'm constantly changing. I feel blessed, I guess, that I've gotten to play these parts. You know, it's not easy either. It's not easy being an actor or doing this stuff, but it's, you look back and like hearing that compliment, that's huge, and that means a lot to me. I'm thankful, you know. I love doing comedy, but I also really love drama, you know. So I don't know, I'm drawn to it all. Thanks.